Oh, who would I pardon if I had pardon power? Well, myself, obviously. And then maybe Ned Stark. Ugh. 3 weeks into Donald Trump's presidency, he fired Michael Flynn as his national security advisor. You remember that. In late November of 2020, 8 weeks to the day when Trump will leave the White House, he pardoned Flynn for lying to the FBI as part of the investigation into Russian interference in the 2016 election. Flynn's rise and fall and sort of reclamation function as fitting bookends, doop doop, of Trump's 4 years in the White House. A testament to the hubris, loyalty, and borderline lawlessness that sit at the heart of the most radical presidency in modern history. Look, that Flynn wound up in the White House at all is pretty telling. His initial appeal to Trump was simple and twofold. One, he was a high-ranking military officer who had served as the head of the Defense Intelligence Agency. And two, he had been removed from that job during the Obama administration after a series of clashes with other government officials. So, Trump's adoration of the military, coupled with his desire to cast himself as the exact opposite of Barack Obama in every possible way, drew him to Flynn. And boy, did Flynn deliver. After a somewhat low-profile career in intelligence, Flynn suddenly blossomed as a hard-edged partisan, willing to say almost anything about Democratic presidential nominee Hillary Clinton and anyone else who got in Trump's way. In a wild and wildly well-received speech at the 2016 Republican National Convention, Flynn said this of Clinton.
Lock her up, lock her up. Damn right. You're exactly right. There's nothing wrong with that. And you know why? And you know why? You know why we're saying that? We're saying that because if I, a guy who knows this business, if I did a tenth of what she did, I would be in jail today.
By the end of the 2016 campaign, Flynn was Trump's preferred warm-up act at the raucous rallies he held all over the country. Flynn knew how to stir the crowd into a boil, and Trump loved him for every minute of it. Which is why it came as no surprise that just 10 days after he beat Clinton in 2016, Trump named Flynn as his national security advisor. He said, quote, "General Flynn is one of the country's foremost experts on military and intelligence matters, and he will be an invaluable asset to me and my administration." And then, suddenly, Flynn was gone. Can't get out of the screen. Just 23 days after Trump became president on January 20th, 2017. Sidebar, in retrospect, Flynn's tenure actually lasted more than two Scaramucci's, which ain't bad, end sidebar. Flynn was forced to resign as national security advisor, according to Trump, for lying to Vice President Mike Pence about the nature and depth of his conversations with Russian officials during the presidential transition process.
He didn't tell the Vice President of the United States the facts, and then he didn't remember. And that just wasn't acceptable to me. I fired him because of what he said to Mike Pence. Very simple.
Now, within the year, Flynn had pleaded guilty to lying to the FBI about his contacts with the Russians. And as CNN wrote on December 1st, 2017, quote, "According to an FBI statement, Flynn communicated with then-Russian ambassador to the U.S., Sergei Kislyak, after being asked by a senior Trump transition official to find out how foreign governments stood on a coming U.N. security resolution about Israel. The prosecutors did not name any transition officials," end quote. Now, in the wake of Flynn's guilty plea, Trump changed his story almost immediately. Stop me if you've heard this. Quote, "I had to fire General Flynn because he lied to the vice president and the FBI," Trump tweeted on December 2nd, 2017, adding, "He has pled guilty to those lies. It is a shame because his actions during the transition were lawful. There was nothing to hide," end quote. So did Trump fire Flynn because Flynn had lied to Pence, lied to the FBI? Both? Neither? Neither? While those questions lingered, Flynn largely dropped off the radar. He was cooperating with Robert Mueller's investigation into Russian meddling in the 2016 election and the possibility of collusion between the Trump campaign and that foreign government. Then things shifted again. In early 2020, Flynn sought to recant his guilty plea, with his legal team accusing prosecutors of, quote, "bad faith, vindictiveness, and breach of the plea agreement," end quote. Suddenly, Flynn was back to being a cause célèbre in Trump's world, an innocent man done wrong by reckless and out-of-control investigators and prosecutors desperate to enforce their own political agendas. You know that story. Of course, there was never any evidence that those involved in Flynn's guilty plea acted in any sort of unethical manner, but that didn't matter to Trump. By May, Trump's Justice Department had dropped the entire case against Flynn, a remarkable move given that he had pleaded guilty under oath to lying to federal investigators as part of a probe into a foreign government's attempts to influence a presidential election. Quote, is James Comey and his band of dirty cops going to apologize to General Michael Flynn and many others for what they have done to ruin his life? Trump tweeted in June about the former FBI director who he fired in May 2017, adding, quote, what about Robert Mueller and his angry Democratic cronies? Are they going to say so sorry? And what about Obama and Biden? Quote, for Trump, Flynn was the poster child of deep state persecution. His life had been ruined, in Trump's telling, by partisans hell-bent on damaging the Trump presidency. Now that story, of course, overlooked the fact that Flynn had, and I'm just reminding you here, pleaded guilty to lying to the FBI and cooperating with the Mueller investigation. And he had done so under oath, and he had done so on more than one occasion. Now seen through that lens, Trump's decision to offer a full pardon to Flynn on his way out of the White House sort of makes perfect sense. Trump sees his own story in Flynn. Both men were loathed by the political establishment. Outsiders, because they wouldn't play by the accepted rules of what Trump saw as a corrupt bureaucracy. Fist shake. They were punished for their loyalty, for their unflagging belief in their own righteousness. In Trump's view, they are the real victims here of a power-obsessed establishment scared to death of losing its grip on the levers of government. Levers. Trump and Flynn have more in common than either is willing to acknowledge, too. Both played fast and loose with facts and pushed hard against the boundaries of acceptable and legal conduct. The similarities between the two men are undeniable, which raises this question. Having pardoned Flynn, might Trump turn the power of the pardon on himself before he leaves office? And that is The Point. We make New Point episodes every Tuesday and Thursday. Check them all out.